Should we make people guess who's in studio?
We announced it already.
Yeah, but the new listeners.
Wait, you announced it? Then I'm leaving. I thought that was the gimmick.
We announced it kind of through Chip Chipperson's game, Words Back.
People didn't really know who it was.
Oh, I don't blame them.
Sam blew it.
We said Bon Rennington was coming in studio.
Okay.
Yeah, because you were guessing as to who might be coming in.
Can I tell you something? I use that to check in the hotel, so I'm not fucked with at all. Have you ever, Jimmy, checked into a hotel under a fake name?
Yeah, I want to check in under a name that nobody would like care about, so I usually just use Jim Norton. I have a couple of times. When I would tour with Dice, we would always check in on fake names. Mm-hmm. And once in a while, but most people don't care. And if someone did call the room, I would just, I think it's happened to me like 3 or 4 times. No one gives a fuck.
Yeah.
It has happened, though?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, but it's not often, and you just put a block on the phone.
What do they say when they get through?
Jimmy!
Dude!
Fucking rock!
Chippo!
What's going on, dude?
So, I don't know. Where's Opie and Anthony? What the hell's going on in here today? Was I here on a strange day?
They franchised us out. Yeah.
Do you guys consider yourself a spinoff show? Is that...
We're the Maud of Morning Radio.
I was going to go Ropers, but this Maud works very well.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. It is so bizarre how it works out. Everyone's doing their different stuff now. It's very weird. I never saw any of this coming. Like, you know, before July of 2014, none of us saw any of this coming.
No, it's crazy. But I was telling Sam before, I thought Ant really fucked it up because I thought you guys got off to a really fun start with it. To me, the funniest thing, and you guys should have kept it, was dividing up the comics. That was the funniest shit ever. And there should have literally been a draft, some trades.
Yeah. Doug Benson started the whole thing.
Yeah.
When he had come in, and we were like, well, okay, you're doing this show. But then Doug said, but I might do Opie's show this afternoon.
Yeah.
Then I'm not coming back to do, like, I'll figure out within the next 6 hours which show I'm loyal to.
I texted him, go ahead. I didn't care. Like, I don't, but it would have been funny to make
everybody would have been talking about it forever. You know, especially when you would have saw who went low on the draft. Like, Voss would have been pissed if he wasn't a first rounder. Nah. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, Voss would have been part of a trade.
For players to be named later. There's some 18-year-old comics that you're really not going to use for another 6-7 years.
Yeah, we'll fucking trade Voss for Pete Davidson's younger brother, who's in third grade. Yeah, you know, you just, I don't give a fuck where everybody goes. I mean, but it is weird. I'm happy we were able to have Anthony on, though. That was what I wanted. The first guest we had was Ant, and that was the guy we wanted to have.
Yeah, but
on.
You couldn't get him in.
Not yet.
You think you're going to?
I don't know. I mean, it's a goal. Obviously, it's no secret. I want him in.
Yeah. I think we will.
I think eventually we will. I mean, there's no reason not to. You know, Artie Lang used to work here. He couldn't come in for a while, and then he comes in.
It's like, oh, I didn't know that he couldn't come in.
No, I think for a while they were a little gun. Maybe there was never a rule about it, but why couldn't Ant? He didn't do anything wrong here.
Ant's picture's up, right? In that room?
It's in the book, yeah.
Is it really?
It was. I mean, it was when he first got. I'm assuming you don't get taken out of the book once you're in the book.
I saw East Side Dave's picture actually on a wall.
Really?
Yeah.
Like Wanted, Dead or Alive?
Yeah, it was really fucking great.
He's not allowed in.
No, he's not allowed in for threatening text.
Yeah.
That's what you can't send threats, dude. Once you do that. That's a little scary. Because then the company's really liable if some shit happens and they had prior knowledge. But Ant never did that.
In his defense, he's a heavy drinker.
Yeah, he is.
He is a very heavy drinker. Why is his pictures up now? Just as we mentioned them, you guys throw up the pictures.
That's what we do here. It sparks discussion. Yeah.
That's fast.
This is the guy you're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's important. I saw it, but I wish Eastside Dave could figure out how to drink successfully. Because the New York Post, the cover story today.
Yeah.
Is that Fallon is a fucking drunk.
Is that the... how did I not see that?
First of all, great pivot. I mean, that's... Seriously, your Thank skills you. Are really
Jimmy
coming
Fallon,
along.
They called it.
Well, that's been talked about for a while, but then they said that the NBC executives wanted him to slow down, which is the funniest thing to say to somebody that you think is an alcoholic.
Well, allegedly Carson was a hard drinker too, but the media was a little different back then. It wasn't everyone had them a fucking smartphone.
Yeah, it didn't exist really. Yeah.
But Carson also, like, his success of his career wasn't dependent on making sure that he got 3 viral videos every
week.
That's
right.
You know what I mean?
That's right.
Like, there has to be results
constantly.
They'd come back on the air and you'd see fucking cigarette smoke still pluming from the fucking commercial break.
Just some fucking Angie Dickinson giving them head under the table. Because he used to also bang a lot of his guests. And you can't
do that.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that was always the thing of in between divorces. He was like, get this broad on. She's great. Get this chick. She's fantastic.
Because he's just fucking all of them.
Yeah, well, you know, adults being adults. I mean, this isn't a Bill Cosby, you know.
Right.
I've got a fucking Flintstone vitamin for you.
And poor David Letterman tries to regain some of that aura, but he's just got to fuck the interns because they don't fuck guests anymore.
That's what I would have done if I was Letterman, though.
Yeah. Fuck the interns.
But, some eager college beaver.
Literally, that's the one thing that every radio station has always agreed on. Don't fuck the interns.
Right.
Because it's really, and you know, even Clinton could not fuck the interns.
Yeah.
You know?
It's hard not to.
Yeah, because they're all happy to be there and they're excited.
They look up to you?
Yeah, right.
That's
Have you ever?
No.
Have you ever been tempted?
Just a male intern, me and Fez fucking threw him down on the ground.
You guys wanted to throw him on the fucking, you wanted to spit roast him?
Yeah. No, actually, I don't even think we even used interns when I started. We used to just fucking hire people.
Because there was money in radio.
Yeah, there was money in radio. And, you know, it was always always weird, like the guy that you would hire would be the weird kid hanging around the balloon at every concert. You're like, hey, he seems to be into it.
Isn't that great? Well, you can't even hire those people as interns anymore.
No.
Because it's a liability.
Yeah. They have to be in college. They have to waste money.
Yes.
To come into radio where there's nothing that you could learn in college that could help you in radio.
Right, there's not.
I was taken off the responsibility years ago of hiring the interns for Opie and Anthony because I would only hire the fun people.
Right.
And they were like, that's not what this is about.
Right.
I'm like, this is all that this is about. What are you talking about?
Right. I actually had that same thing with HR here. We said, all right, we picked a kid. And they go, he's really weird. And I go, yeah.
That's
the fucking guy we want.
Sure. Right. Because on the air, he's valuable.
Yeah. I don't want a young whippersnapper that's got his eye on the ball. That's fucking crazy.
Right.
Yeah. You want Martini who's going to throw the ball into the fence.
Exactly. And then we could go, what the fuck did you do, Martini?
Yeah, you threw the ball into the fence.
But really, if Jack Nicholson would have had a really good ball player with him, that scene is fucking destroyed.
Yeah. Absolutely. Nobody wants Kobe Bryant on the fucking field. You want a giant Indian who probably smothered somebody before the movie.
Oh, you don't think that was the first smothering?
No, I don't. No, he had perfect hand placement and his shoulder. He put his shoulder into it.
Yeah.
No, you don't get up to the plate and hit a home run like that the first time.
Come on, did you cry a little bit when fucking the Chief?
Many times.
Yeah.
I cry almost every time I watch that movie.
Yeah, it's an unbelievable ending scene.
I didn't cry during that. I've only cried, I think, during one movie. And I'm sure it was other shit going on.
Let me guess, The Woodsman.
Was it No Holds Barred?
Yes, it was. I was rooting for Zeus the whole time. I cried during that movie, Room, recently. The Brie Larson movie.
Yeah, why?
I cried three times during that movie.
Fucking puss.
Three times.
He probably felt bad for the guy losing the kid. You're like, oh, I never would have fallen for that trick. Always molest him when he's rolled up in the carpet.
I didn't even bother. I don't like to watch movies where something bad happens to a kid.
Yeah.
I also don't like to watch a movie where a dog gets killed. I'm like, no, I'll fucking avoid that.
Yeah, you see Marley in the Room? That was a terrible combination.
Yeah, I was just talking about that the other day because there's a...
When did you cry during the Room?
I cried. It was all like, this is how bad. It was tears of like hopefulness. Like I cry like when you find out that Brie Larson is still alive and she's gonna get reunited with the kid after the kid escapes, you know, when she runs out of the house.
Oh yeah. That one a little bit.
When the kid gets a dog, when the kid moves into the parents' house and they bring him a dog and all the kids ever wanted was a dog. I cried at that part too.
I cried when that man interfered with private business.
What man?
Remember when I was outside in the yard and the guy came over and interrupted the conversation?
No, I remember.
Cried.
Yeah. You mean when he was trying to stop the kidnapper...
Mind your business.
...from taking the kid back into the shed to continue to rape his mom?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I Cuckoo's Nest gets me every time. There's certain movies, I'm a fucking crybaby during movies.
Yeah.
It makes me feel, I've said this before, it makes me feel normal. Like you're supposed to feel sad for it. Like, I'm not a detached fucking sociopath. Like, I really do.
Are you sure, Jim?
No. Maybe I'm at the wrong times I'm crying.
I felt that way. Like, where you want to emote. Like, you're like, I'm supposed to emote here. I'm supposed to have emotions.
It just happens.
And I'm sitting there going like, all right, I think I'm going to cry. Like, I try to work myself into a cry, and it just doesn't.
Oh, I know. It just happens.
Yeah, in real life.
Yeah. So you're at a funeral. No. Everyone else is crying. You're like, what's up?
I think the tears are going to come. I think the tears. No, I meant when I'm watching movies, and there's like, I think, no, I'm relating to this scene. I think I'm going to squeeze a tear out. I think. No, it's not coming.
I tried something recently, but it's always embarrassing when you're... You're in an audience, or you're public. What else did you cry besides Cougar's Nest?
Well, the Brian song was my initial that my whole family was like fucking laughing because I was crying. Seriously, I was crying like I lost a family member, you know? When he gave that speech.
Brian Piccolo.
Yeah.
Have you watched it recently?
No, I haven't.
A piece of shit.
I'm sure, because it was a TV movie, right?
Dude, it's so bad. I tweeted
recently.
We just
watched this recently.
Yeah, we did. It was so bad. Man, it's so brave, like Brian Piccolo. Fucking boo, Billy D.
Billy D.
It was
Williams.
Awful.
You know, James Caan went to TV after The Godfather. I mean, that was worth tears right there alone. That man had fallen so quickly.
Yeah, he was really, he was less humiliated on the causeway than he was in that fucking hospital bed. But that was sad. That was one of mine when I was a kid. You know, Ricky Schroeder in The Champ made me cry.
Yeah,
I was a fucking blubbering idiot.
You know, there's like a 1930s version of The Champ with Wallace Beery and Jackie Cooper.
Oh.
It's even fucking sadder.
Really?
Even sadder, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. But yeah, that kid, Ricky Schroeder is still dancing off that fucking tune. You know, it's a long time now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, people know who he is.
Now he's Rick Schroeder.
Well, I don't blame him. You know what I mean?
But don't they know him from Silver Spoons?
Yeah, but that's where he got that gig.
With Carlton?
Oh. He got that gig because
the
world cried. Yeah. That was, you know, it was a game changer for him. He was 9 years old. Nothing was happening.
That's right.
And he gets cast in that movie and he's off to the races.
He was considered washed up.
Yeah.
Did a Pampers commercial when he was 18 months. Nothing since.
But isn't it always funny when those guys bitch about that? You know, like, hey, I don't want to be remembered for... You know, like most people aren't remembered for anything.
Right,
man.
Just be remembered for
fucking
something.
Take it, you know?
Most of the time when people get older, they realize like, fuck, I should have just cashed in on that and just be remembered for that thing. Like, just be, like, I've spoken to the other kid from Silver Spoons, Carlton.
Ooh.
And like, he still has issues being associated with Carlton from Fresh Prince. He doesn't like to do the dance. He doesn't like to do any of that. But you can tell now that it's been several years, he knows there's not any other giant thing coming.
Will Smith never fucking had a problem with it. You know what I mean? Will Smith went out and did all the shit immediately. Like, yeah, that's still me.
Right. But Will Smith was smart enough to be like, if I line up some good gigs and continue to do the Fresh Prince stuff, I'll continue to be beloved.
Maybe nobody will know I'm gay. That was his fucking thing.
Oh, yeah?
Jump. Maybe nobody will know. Maybe. I don't know.
I've heard the rumors.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're true. I mean, I've never heard them like... I've just heard it as a rumor in the wind. I've never heard it detailed, like, no, he did this or that.
Well, Bert Kreischer says he's not gay because Bert spent the night with him and nothing happened. Bert hung out with him, but...
Yeah.
Will Smith?
Yeah, but...
Have you heard that story?
I mean, no. Of all the guys Will Smith could get.
Yeah, why would you fuck Bert?
Yeah.
But it is, like, it's fishy. That
Bert's an end-of-the-night blowjob in the car.
And he knows this. Yeah. We're not saying anything. We all are.
But just the fact that, like... Will wanted to hang out with Bert. He was inviting him to go see movies and stuff. Yeah. Like, there's
was
something.
He?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, he was interested in his career at the time. That thing had blown up for him.
The article?
Yeah.
What article?
Yeah, he's the party boy or whatever.
When he the Van Wilder article that they just stole and made a movie off of.
Maybe Will likes the chubby guys.
It's possible.
I know another actor who's gay who likes the chubby guys.
Who?
I don't know if he's out.
Why don't you just write it down?
Okay.
What movie was he in?
The Godfather. It's Marlon something.
Oh, Jim's writing it down.
No, I'm not going to say it. If he's not out, I'm not going to out him.
All right.
I don't know if he is or not, so I'm not going to say it.
Yeah, I don't think so.
I don't know if he is.
I don't think so.
I think I can see that, you know? I think that works, though.
Yeah, but he likes him chubby.
I think I've always been bad about misplacing emotions. I only remember crying. I don't remember crying ever during a movie when I was a kid, but I cried when I was reading that book Super Fudge. Did your kids ever read the book Super Fudge?
No, my children don't read. I raised them in Florida.
I see.
Wasn't big there.
In the book Super Fudge, like the kid's got a bad younger brother, you know? And
Judy Blume?
It's a Judy Blume book.
Oh, yuck.
And the
are
younger...
you there, God? It's me, douche.
The younger brother eats the pet turtle. Like he's got a little pet turtle. The younger brother eats the turtle.
What?
Then they have to rush the kid to the hospital. The doctor fixes him. Everything's okay in the end because the younger brother's okay. And I went downstairs crying to my mother because the turtle was dead. Now, I completely missed the point of the book at all.
What kind of fucking book is that for kids?
I don't know. I don't know. It's too much for me. Way too much for me because the turtle died.
You don't want to see the turtle die. I mean, who wants to see that? I'd rather see it slowly tortured. He has little turtle feet cut off, make him live like that. Crawl around in the broken glass, that, shithead.
Yeah. You cut off its feet, it's just a rock at that point. That's where rocks come from, kids.
Yeah, the fucking turtles who got in the wrong fucking, got in someone's way.
No, I think we had very different childhoods. But yeah, I couldn't handle it at all. At all.
I'm trying to think besides, I mean, there's a million movies that make me blubber like a little fruit. I can't think of any.
We used to come in, I don't know, you used to come in and like talk about commercials you'd seen that made you cry.
I'm sure they did.
Like you go through periods of life where you cry easily.
Yeah. Menopausal, old fucking fat-headed, mediocre success. I'm trying to think of one I just can't off the top of my head.
Off the top of your head.
Fucking million of them.
You don't cry anymore, Ron, do you?
No, I'm so fucking scarred by what I've seen of life by this point.
Yes.
You know, I go, just, there goes another one, you know?
Yeah.
When Kevin Meaney died the other day, I'm like, oh, of course, that's how this fucking game's played.
Right. Yeah.
You know, take a fucking sweetheart like him.
Yeah. With no heads up.
No heads up. He was working out. He was taking care of himself.
Yeah.
He was doing everything.
He was out. He was happy.
Yes, he was out.
He's only 60, right?
Yeah. 60, yeah. Did you guys used to see him when he was working here? He'd be around every day.
I did Jay Thomas' show with him a few times.
He's always a good dude, man.
Nice guy.
Always a good guy.
He's always laughing about something, too.
Yeah. Did you see the thing that Louis wrote up? Because he put out Barry Crimmins.
Yes.
And then he wrote in the thing. It was like amazing.
It was really good.
Yeah.
It was really good. Louis wrote a tribute to him. I think Variety pushed it out or something like that. But he sent it out to his email list.
Yeah.
And just said his reflections on Kevin Meaney. But it was really, really good.
Yeah. He was a really loved guy by comics. Comics really loved him.
Yeah.
And it sucks. You start taking care of yourself and you just drop dead.
It doesn't fucking matter.
No,
nothing
it doesn't.
Matters.
It doesn't.
Death is right there with a fucking knife ready to stick at your neck every chance.
It is, right?
Yeah. But here's the thing. He had one heart attack. Fez has had 145.
Right.
You know?
There's no rhyme or reason to any of it.
Yeah.
There's no rhyme or reason. That's where you watch like all those Netflix documentaries about all the foods you can't eat. Like, fuck them.
Yeah, what the heck? Sometimes I have a Twinkie and I say caution to the wind.
That's
really
good.
Great.
Back to you,
That's
Sam.
That's good. I'll put Coke all over the fucking top of it. Snort it first and off we go.
Yeah.
But you only eat cut up hot dogs?
No,
that's
I don't
the
eat.
Only thing
yes.
that you eat?
Yes, if they don't cut them up, he sits on them.
That's what you gotta watch for with children.
Yeah. My parents learned the hard way.
Yeah. They sure did. Where's those kielbasa? Well,
he cries when it falls.
No, I just eat chicken.
That's it?
Yeah.
What do you have for breakfast?
I'll eat an apple.
Ugh.
And then I'll go home. Chicken or
apple for breakfast.
And that's it? Until you go home and then you have a piece of chicken?
Why not just, like, there's food trucks outside. So stop there. I'll either get a chicken cheesesteak or chicken fingers, depending on what truck's there.
How good is a chicken cheesesteak off a truck?
It's the fucking best.
There's nothing that could be cooked on a truck properly.
Probably not, no.
No.
What do you mean?
Nothing.
There's that one on 6th Avenue that always has that line.
They all suck.
No.
Even that one? Have you been to
the... the one with the Indian food?
Which is the one that has the long line?
Oh, yeah, that's the halal.
What's the name of it?
Halal guys.
The halal guys.
But that's not a truck. That's a cart.
Whatever it is, but I mean, they always have a line.
They opened up stores now. They have freestanding buildings. That's how well their fucking cart
They're really good, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
But I didn't eat it.
I get excited because you walk in the morning, and you can see that the food trucks are already parked out for the afternoon.
I'm bored.
I always go to the food trucks.
It's horrible.
Why do you think that?
How could someone cook good in a truck?
All you need is a grill.
A fucking grill has to be years old to taste good.
Mm.
You know, you ever go into a diner and they get a new grill, everyone said, this blows. It's fucking terrible. I've never gotten anything good. Now, there's trucks around the country that are really buildings. You know, like when you go to Austin, they're there every day. Or if guys are grilling outside of the fucking truck. but forget it. They fucking sell pizzas and trucks
around
here.
I've seen that pizza food truck. That thing is the worst thing. Yeah. It's like this beige truck that's glass all around, and it got. Is there a pizza oven
it's
in
great.
It?
I've laid under a coffee table like that.
Danny Thomas. Fucking invented that. That should be just called the Danny Thomas. And I don't even know if that's true.
Yeah, like a sandwich at Sardi's.
But there's only one food to get out of a truck, ice cream.
That's it?
Yeah.
But they only have soft serve ice cream in a truck.
I know I'm fucking kidding when I said that. It's for children.
Right.
To chase down the street.
Right.
You don't want a fucking chicken cheesesteak truck driving around ringing a bell in the fucking suburbs.
I would like a chicken cheese. I would like to try it. Now I'm going to Philly this weekend. Now you're making me crave a cheesesteak. I haven't had one in a year or two.
God bless you for that. Go get it.
Fucking amazing.
Go get a hoagie instead, though. You eat hoagies?
I do, but not in a long. I'm trying to lose the weight.
Go to what? Wait, you got left to lose.
I got right.
A more right there.
You can treat yourself, Jim. You can
treat yourself.
Treat yourself.
Treat yourself. What was that from? Treat yourself. Oh, Andrew,
Parks
the homeless guy.
Parks and Rec.
Oh, I thought it was from Andrew.
And
treat
and
yourself.
Andrew. Yeah. Treat yourself. Yeah.
So you lost yourself. You were in a whole thing. This is your job to steer the show, and then you just went shit, yeah. Fucking radio.
That's right. Had that nice little moment.
How you watching the? Did you watch the first game of the World Series?
Yeah, I watched every pitch.
I did you? Not. How was it? I'm just sick of these teams.
They just got the fucking Cubs got crushed.
What was the score?
6-0.
Oh, okay.
6-0.
Where?
I mean, in Cleveland.
Yeah,
in Cleveland. Right. The weird thing was every time the fucking Cubs get a hit, you hear a pretty big fucking cheer. Mm-hmm. A lot of Chicago people were in that stadium.
Yeah.
But.
I watched an inning and a half, and then I was.
That was it was 2-0 when you fucking.
I saw it at 3-0.
So,
and I said, yeah, I get where. I think it's
I
like
get it.
I watched the seventh inning, I think, and I was like, yeah, I know where this is going.
Well, you know when the great and this is the best thing about this series is how tense it gets between pitches to these people because these people are living and dying with each pitch. Mm. No, most sports move at a pretty good clip,
right?
Where you don't have time to sit there and put your hands over your eyes,
right?
But the tension of this is great,
right?
It reminded me of the way people felt. Right before the debates, remember, like, everybody in the country was really fucking
what are they going to say?
Who's going to fuck it up?
Yeah.
Who's going to fuck this up?
Yeah. Yeah. And they're so grateful, too. I saw them give, like, when Cleveland took their pitcher off, he got a standing ovation just for the work that he had done. He got somebody on base, and they were like, all right, you're done. And everybody just loved
him. Yeah,
that
was a hell of a night he had.
I know.
He struck out 8 of the first 9 batters or something crazy. You know?
Bad night for the Cubbies.
It's all over now.
By the way, what's the song? Rockin' Tribe remix by Ben Metzger.
Do you want it?
It's Kurt Metzger's son. Yeah.
Well, you know,
I'd rather hear the other Metzger, the fucking white supremacist.
He's doing well.
A lot of the fans are very excited for both teams.
Is this good though?
I think it's pretty good.
Ronnie, have you heard this?
No, I haven't heard it.
A guy named Ben Ryan Metzger put out a song called Cleveland Indian Song Rockin' Tribe. Is that what it's
good.
Called?
These sports songs are usually pretty cool.
Yeah.
You like sports songs there?
Yeah, they always get me. You know what I mean? My favorite's banana, but only since I found out about Gary.
Sure. Takes on a different meaning.
Heading to Vietnam. I thought she was 10. And then you know what's great? They never got rid of that song.
How could they?
People still fucking play kazoo to it at every game.
They even changed the end of it. They go, banana, wah!
I think the Rockin' Tribe remix may be the new anthem, though.
It's got 1,088 likes to only 9 dislikes.
Wow.
That's pretty impressive, folks.
Yeah, we're going to give it
maybe it's
going to give it a spin. A little smash your trash.
This is Cleveland, Ohio. We're going all in tonight. We're rocking baseball. We're rocking tribe. And you better be ready to dig down deep in the game of your life. Yeah, here we go now. Swing for the fences in your field of dreams.
One guy dancing alone in a room.
Step up to the plate and embrace your
and
destiny.
Snapping.
Yeah, rally together and hold on tight because we're going for the win. Fire up your Indian pride. We're rocking baseball. We're rocking tribe.
I'm sold.
You love it.
I do, yeah. It's not awful.
What do you mean?
It's not awful.
Because it's supposed to be ridiculous.
The cream and you will make it
it's silly.
I see that
there's a lot of commitment put into
everybody
it.
Silly, yeah. Who is watching this lives in Chicago. They're the ones upvoting it. I love the armbands. Is those armbands? Or
the armbands are awesome.
Yeah. Looks, he's got armbands and he's got wristbands on, too, just in case he builds up a sweat.
He looks like Conan O'Brien.
I'm sure it's, we can't see him, but I'm sure there's ankle bands there
as
well.
Oh, yeah, and he's got the, it looks like the Britney Spears microphone on.
Yeah.
With the hands free.
Yeah.
Because he's going, he's doing spins.
The guy can move, too, let's be honest.
Yeah.
I mean, it's fun to tease, but he can move.
He's a dancer.
Yeah, that was so ridiculous.
He's a singer-dancer. I mean,
Oh, I took that as being silly. I didn't take that as being serious.
Will Smith
he was really committing to it. Yeah, exactly.
What?
Will Smith just offered him a deal. Come to LA. I would love to see you.
I would say he's probably realizing it's a bit silly, but he put a lot of time and effort into that. He wrote the song. He choreographed the dance. He's not making it up as he goes.
He moved the furniture out of the fucking room, which isn't easy to do.
I'm pretty sure he's being serious. He's got 102,000 followers on Twitter. Like, he's a legit singer-songwriter.
But he also had those shoes that Gervais wore in the original Office.
You didn't think they were good?
I didn't think you could get heels like that. You still find them?
Holy shit. This is another video.
Oh, boy.
He's got ankle bands on.
Sweet. Yeah.
Look at him, Ron. He's got ankle bands on.
And knee pads, too.
Yeah, that's needed. In that fucking room.
Had no hope and no dream.
This guy's a performance artist.
It's the same dance, though.
It is the same dance.
But he's got a, I hate to say, fluidity.
Oh, yeah.
That I admire.
There's a flow there.
It really is the exact same dance. It's just a guy spinning around.
Yeah, let's see you spin.
Doing ballet moves.
I think he's great to work in a place without indoor air like that. He's still got the fucking window piece like it's 1970.
Yes, he does.
His dad didn't take it out yet. That was really the thing.
It's probably warm in there, too, because he doesn't have it on. I don't hear it.
What a clean floor, though, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Perfect. Look, Gregory Hines could go nuts in that fucking room.
Not a scuff mark on it.
He'd go nuts. Just the idea that he would start fucking freaking out.
Such a clean floor.
This is fucking great.
I got a tap.
Yeah.
I feel like I think Cleveland should put that on the big screen for the game.
Yeah.
You know?
I do.
Give him his props. He came up with it.
He certainly did. And he did a good job.
I said, swing for the fences in your field of dreams.
What is that voice?
It's country, right? He's like doing a country song.
I guess he is doing a little country.
We've got what it takes. Bring him home tonight.
I like that he wears fucking suit pants.
It's very strange, man.
He wears suit pants and red socks. This guy's awesome.
Here we go.
You think Cleveland has to look at this like these are our fans? This is
look.
This
so
is
many
who we're
people have
for.
Left Cleveland. They're just happy to have anything going.
Yeah,
their way
there's
right
just somebody.
He's actually billed as the last white person downtown.
Keep speaking truth right to the blind. There will be justice.
I don't know.
You still love it?
I'm looking to make Roadhouse 2, and I think I found my star.
He's perfect.
Because remember in the 80s, no one could figure out why that dude, you know, like this fucking big cut dude danced like he did.
Uh-huh.
Roadhouse. I think his name was Roadhouse. I think the movie was named after him.
I would imagine.
Yeah.
Look at him. And you know what? This guy, he's wearing a tight black t-shirt. No pit stains.
How long?
Oh, he's got the air.
His song is endless.
It just keeps going.
Yeah, I've had enough.
You don't like this as much as the World Series song?
No, he's too well built, this guy, to dance.
Put the World Series song back on, Adrian. I think we can make Jim feel a little better.
Rockin' Tribe. Rockin' Tribe is the name of it.
You still like this?
Not as much since I've seen the other ones.
I didn't think so.
It's lost its luster.
This would have been better if he would have put it out in June. Not October. This guy's been there since day one.
Right.
But now you look like a bandwagon jumper.
He's a
total sitter.
I'm a big Cubs fan, though, so I want to see the Cubbies pull it out. Turn it down a little bit.
When did you become a Cubs fan?
Shit.
What does shit mean? When did you become a Cubs fan?
Yeah, you know. A while ago.
I don't think so.
Cubbies.
I don't think so.
Go Cubbies. The Ivy Wall out there. Chi-town.
Oh, you know your shit.
Windy City.
Windy City, man.
Oh, wow. You sound like a local.
Yeah, yeah. You sit down there, you deep dish a little, watch the Cubbies play ball.
Now, is that what they call eating deep dish pizza? Deep dishing?
Yeah, they deep dish.
Oh, I didn't realize.
Yeah.
Hey, you guys want to go and deep dish tonight?
Yeah, let's go deep dish and check out some Cubbies over the Ivy Wall.
What? That's what they say.
Yeah.
Little known fact, too, Bill Murray's from Chicago. Not a lot of people know that.
Oh, I didn't know that. Is he a Cubs? Is he a Cubs fan?
He loves the Cubbies.
Who knew?
Yeah, he's deep dishing out there the other night with John Q. Cusack and the guy from Pearl Jam.
I saw that. Just the gang deep dishes together.
Yeah. Is he a big Cubs fan, though?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody from Chicago just, you know.
To me, the White Sox are the heart and soul of that city.
Do you think so?
Isn't that Obama's team, the White Sox?
Yeah, because they're Southsiders.
Oh.
Where there's all the murders.
Is he a White Sox fan?
Yeah.
I just found this out the other day. I thought he was a Cubs fan.
No.
Because of the way he talks.
Oh, I forget he's a Chicago guy. Yeah, he's probably at least rooting for the Cubs.
You know, Hillary grew up a Chicago fan until she moved to New York. Then she put on a Yankees cap. That was a big fucking deal at the time.
Genuine woman when it comes to sports. That's why I like her.
Yeah, I like her a lot, so, you know.
I felt like she was just moving wherever she went. She would just change her hat.
That's fun, though. You know what I mean? Like, to join in what everybody's doing. Oh, that's what you guys are doing.
My team.
Military brats have to grow up that way. They have to adapt quickly.
Just going from place to place,
going from team to team. Just acting like, oh, I got to get rid of my old sneakers. No one. That's what the kids here are wearing.
Right. No loyalty. No sense of individuality, really.
You don't think that he had a scorecard going, right? Because he sings that in the song.
He may have.
There's nothing worse to me than a little kid with the scorecard fucking acting like I'm never going to get to play. So I'll sit here. You've never seen that at a game where people...
No. I mean, no. I know. My dad used to go to those games and fill out the fucking scores.
No.
You hate that?
Well, yes.
How come?
No, he wouldn't. He'd be just handing notes to your mother saying we should have aborted it.
Yeah.
Well, because the thing
leave when he's in the bathroom.
There's someone that fills out that card, and it's in the paper the next day.
Right.
There's no one going to say years from now, does anyone have a scorecard? Because I saw a million people. The old people used to do it when I went to spring training games, old ladies.
Mm-hmm.
But no little kid. A little kid should be like, I want to make the team.
Right.
They give the fucking score thing to a kid who's not going to make it. Normally a kid with braces on his legs.
I see.
Yeah.
I see. And they're like, all of a sudden, this dream that they had is to be a sports journalist.
Right.
And you're like, I don't want to play baseball. I want to write about it.
Yeah.
Do you really legs?
Do kids still do that? Do they still?
No. Kids don't even go to games.
They don't, right? I always figured that the scorecard
was
just something to do to pass the time. Because baseball, no matter how big a fan you are, it's a boring sport.
It really, well, the scorecard is you don't need it anymore. I got in 1974 maybe, but now it's like you get your phone, you just pick it up, boom.
It's all right there.
Well, it's also on a big board, right?
No, you could get a book of them.
Oh.
Or like a notebook full of them.
Oh, and so that way you can have your record of all the games that you went to and what the scores were.
That's OCD. Yeah. That's someone's OCD. I would love to know. I bet you there's somebody out there with literally 1,000 scorecards.
I'm sure.
Right.
They're not going to throw them away. They've done this important work.
Yeah, hey, look, if anyone got any questions on the Brewers in 81, I have all the scorecards.
No, just Google it.
Yeah,
it's online.
No, but if you got any Gorman Thomas trivia.
But they want that to be, like, they want that memory. It's not enough to have the memory. Like, you need something tangible.
Yep.
Right.
To be like, here's proof of the memory.
This way
it's never going to go away. Ever.
Yeah, I remember when we were a kid, like in Little League, you'd go over to the kid with the scorecard and be like, better fucking change that to a hit. That wasn't an hour. I got fucking caught yelling from first base. That was a fucking hit. I'm yelling at the kid. Change it. And the coach is like, we're down fucking 17-3. And you want a hit. This is why. No one considers you a leader.
But yeah, they didn't consider you a team player.
No, it wasn't much of a team player.
Hey, does Phil Collins talk about Sudi in that book?
Yeah, he said he recorded in the studio. I don't think he's going to let off, like, not bring up studio. He was, you know, on Fallon last night, he was ripping Paul McCartney.
Was he really?
Yeah, he said Paul McCartney treats everybody like shit. Like, when you go to talk to him, he acts like, this must be difficult for you, I'm a Beatle. You know, no one ever rips Paul. Well,
wow.
John
did. Did he really?
He's hated McCartney for years.
Oh, has he?
Yeah, because McCartney called him Little Phil.
See,
I bet McCartney just dismissed him, and McCartney's one of the only guys that could talk to Phil Collins like, you shitbag.
It scars people. Ask Marco.
I'll be honest.
Marco is still feeling it. Little Phil is not forgiven.
I met McCartney once. He was lovely.
Yeah.
Lovely man.
How long did you talk to him for?
5 seconds.
Yeah, okay.
You know what's fucking weird? I was standing on the street one time, right? And McCartney just comes walking by, just down the street, nobody with him. It was down in front of the old comics. Oh, sure. And it was the fucking craziest thing. We're like, there's fucking Paul McCartney. And Eastside Dave was inside and missed him, and he's a huge Beatles fan. And I go, dude, you're not going to fucking believe this. I go, Paul McCartney just walked by. And he goes, bullshit, where? So I point, and he's like down the block, and he's crossing the street, and Dave just takes off like a fucking Irish setter, and he's running hard across traffic and just runs at Paul McCartney. And you see Paul McCartney do like an old man back up, like this is the end. I'm the new John Lennon.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And this is like, it was like fucking hilarious and frightening at the same time, like hanging out with Dave as always.
Right.
You know? But it was really one of the most funny, horrible things I've ever seen.
What did he
place.
Say to him?
I think he just screamed, you're Paul McCartney, you were in the Beatles.
He doesn't always, Dave doesn't like think ahead of time. Like he doesn't think, okay, what am I going to say once I have this interaction?
Well, I thought he handled the Guns N' Roses meetings well, put something in his hiney, jumped up and down.
This is what Phil Collins said about Paul McCartney, I guess in an article. Sunday Times. He has this thing when he's talking to you where he makes you feel, I know this must be hard for you because I'm a Beatle, I'm Paul McCartney, and it must be very hard.
And he put on a condescending Scouse accent, whatever that is. And I'll do the accent because I'm a linguist.
That's good.
You're more of a voice artist.
I know this must be hard for you because I'm a Beatle.
Cockney is not condescending.
I'm Paul McCartney, and it must be very hard for you to actually be holding a conversation with me.
See, here's fucking Paul's problem. He wants to be an equal. You're not going to be. You came after
Phil's
the guy.
Problem.
Yeah, Phil's
yeah.
problem.
Yeah.
Phil's problem is you're never going to be a Beatle.
Yep.
That's
no.
it. That's the deal.
There's very few people that could sit in with McCartney comfortably. Like Phil Collins probably uncomfortable talking because no matter how well you've done, you didn't write fucking Yesterday.
Right.
You think Ozzy could?
No, Ozzy worships him.
Right.
Lemmy worshipped him. And Brian Johnson worships him. They all worship McCartney. You know who could sit with McCartney comfortably? Keith Richards.
Keith Richards, Mick Jagger.
Mick Jagger.
Brian Wilson.
Even though he's ahead of those guys, Brian Wilson could sit with him. Could. Hey, what's up, dummy?
Pete Townsend, probably. Anybody that was part of that group.
Right.
Part of that group.
Because on some level, they feel contemporaries.
Yeah.
Even Robert Plant. Would have to give a little reverence to him because I know you're Zeppelin, but the Beatles are Trump Led Zeppelin. They just do.
Yeah.
They just do. You know, you could sit with him. Chuck Berry could sit with McCartney or Little Richard. Those guys.
Sure. And then Paul would be like, holy shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Those guys, the Beatles, the Stones really looked up to and paid great tribute to. Bo Diddley. Like all those guys could be very, very relaxed around him.
And it's generational. That's all. Just generational. Who came first?
Right.
You know?
Right.
And you should look up to the guys who came before you. It's just part of life.
You're supposed to.
Can we hear? Yeah. Can we hear any of that? I would love to hear.
That was a print article.
Oh, on Fallon.
I think he said it on Fallon last night.
And it continued. Adrian had the main quote.
Oh my God, is that him there?
Yeah.
He sounded great last night.
I'm sure he did. Oh, he sang a new song.
He sang In the Air Tonight.
Never heard that one.
Was that new?
Yes.
In the Air Tonight.
Yeah. He married a one-legged woman. All right, let's hear it.
You really never heard In the Air Tonight?
No, I meant what he said.
Oh,
Sam.
He's the
Red Cheese. I don't know. That's the new Pearl Jam.
Is this the Paul McCartney quote?
I don't think they have it. Maybe he never said it then.
Maybe it never happened. I don't watch Jimmy Fallon's show because he's a drunk.
I don't support drinkers.
He's a drunk.
He's a drinker.
You know who doesn't drink? That wonderful James Corden. Everybody's saying that Fallon is obsessively jealous with him.
Why?
Because James Corden's like the big competition now.
He isn't though. He's not even on at the same time.
No, but he's the only other one who's got any buzz.
Well, he's got karaoke. Is that it?
Karaoke. Yeah.
Yeah.
He probably would hear that and go, God damn it! I should have thought of that. Yeah. No. I mean, none of the other guys that are on at the same time as Fallon are doing anything like Fallon, but Corden is.
Why would Jimmy care though? Build a fucking fort out of $100 bills and just sit in
be
it all
cool.
day. Yeah. Yeah, I don't even think, I mean, you know, ratings wise, there's so far less people watching Corden.
Yeah, no, there are a lot less because it's on a different network. And because, like you said, it's on at 12:30. But I think Jimmy Fallon, like, he separated himself really not only by getting all the ratings, but he did the lip sync show. Like, that's his show. He's the producer on it. And then when Corden can come out and be like, oh, yeah, well, one of my bits is a show, too.
Really? That's what people worry about at that fucking level, though?
I think so. It's fucking crazy that, like, that's what's going into making skits now, though, for late night shows. It's like, how do we spin this off into a series? How do we make this into an executive
series, yeah.
Yeah, but these things are all terrible. To watch all people lip sync is terrible.
But there is a brilliance. Like, it's a weird,
I'll tell you what the brilliance
mindless
is.
Thing that you can just watch. And I think that's what, there's no thing. It's just silly to watch Michelle Obama singing, you know, well, we are the champions.
That's the brilliance, is they figured out a way to get big stars that shouldn't be doing it to do it. Like, mm-hmm. That's all that there is. Like, they get The Rock to do it. They get whoever it is. They get Michelle Obama
to do
carpool.
They asked me to do it. I said, no.
Good.
I don't want to do it.
Which one? Lip sync or carpool?
They're different, right?
They are.
Yeah. Why don't you just say yes, and then when they announce that you'll be there, they'll pull out.
Don forgot to tell them I died.
But it is. I mean, that's what goes into it. It's like you have to come out with viral shit, and you have to come out with spinoffs now, because the business isn't, it's not enough to just be a TV show host anymore.
Yeah, of course it is. Fallon is already fucking set.
Till 2021,
he's still. Untouchable, though.
Yeah, but you know, they want to be the most important thing in late night.
Who cares? The fucking show is guys playing pizza frisbee. You know what I mean? Like, do you guys ever sit down and watch any late night show? It's fucking, I don't, it's,
I watch Kimmel sometimes.
Shit.
I like Kimmel.
Kimmel, yeah. Just had President B.O. on.
Barack Obama.
That's right.
President B.O.
I'm fast.
I didn't like that they had Obama reading mean tweets, and I'm like, those aren't half as mean as the tweets Obama gets.
Yeah, I know. They should have Obama reading Anthony tweets.
Just sitting there.
Listen to these tweets that Obama read.
Barack Obama is the Nickelback of presidents.
Really?
Obama,
yeah,
couldn't
a lot
negotiate
that
getting
that.
A Whopper without pickles.
It starts the same way.
At Woodstock Dave. Thanks, Dave.
I'll pickles.
I bet Obama likes mustard on his hot dogs because he's gross. At Duck Punks. Just found out my daughter shares a birthday with Obama. Puke. In caps. At Mom of Four Munchkins. Barack Obama dances like how his jeans look. You know, this jeans thing, this is so old. This was years ago, come on. My mom bought a new conditioner, and it sucks. It isn't even conditioning my hair. I blame Obama. Barack Obama. Bro, do you even lift? Well, I lifted the ban on Cuban cigars. That's worth something.
Yeah. Just ad-libbing, yeah. I do like that he's reading those. I like that Obama did it, but the bit itself, it's like, I mean, you know, those aren't exactly mean tweets.
Well, yeah, but he's the president of the United States. You can't have him reading horrible. Right. The fact that he's reading that, Reagan never would have done this.
No, he wouldn't have.
His wife's a skinny, vomit-looking bitch. You know, that's a good Reagan.
You guys going to miss Obama when he leaves?
I like him, you know, yeah. I really do. I don't agree with everything he did, but I like him as a person.
I'm going to miss this election cycle when Obama leaves.
Did you guys hear what Trump said on the bus?
Yeah, it was unbelievable. Unbelievable, this guy.
Yeah, Andrew Dice Trump, right? Am I right or wrong? Ah, you fired! Grab a cunt! Oh!
Yeah, that's what I'm going to miss. I'm going to miss the Hillary-Donald battle.
But who are you picking?
I'm going either
if you say either Hillary or Donald, I'll fucking kiss you on the mouth.
I'm either going to go Hillary. That's what you've been saying this whole time.
But it's true. Are you stealing my shit?
No, I'm going to do either a third party or a write-in or somebody that's not going to win.
Who's going to win, though?
Hillary.
I think Hillary.
Ms. Locked?
Yeah.
I got Trump taking off 50 states. Lock it in.
All of them.
Yeah, people don't realize how many people don't talk to pollsters. They just won't do it.
Right.
They're ashamed. But they're there and they're coming out. I see the signs.
Well, I saw.
You think so? You really think Trump?
100%. I see the signs. The signs are out there.
What are the? You mean literally the
literally
signs on lawns?
Literally see the signs.
Yeah,
as soon as
it says Trump on it.
You're gonna leave the city to see a sign. Have you ever seen a Hillary sign?
No.
50 states.
No. There's a professor.
He'll never take Minnesota. It's very liberal there.
Minnesota?
Never.
All right, so maybe 49 states.
Ron, there's a lot of blue states.
Here's the thing that Obama said, too, and he said this the other night on Kimmel. He said George H.W. Bush talks down to him like he's nothing. And he has some weird accent.
Yeah.
So, I guess because he came before. You know why he came before?
Somewhere. But
you know, when we were talking about that next level thing, this kid says to me the other day, he's a young comedian, and he said that he had done something for, you know, he was opening for Colin at that black pussycat.
Yeah.
So he was opening in that room for him. And then later he goes, and Nick DiPaolo came in. He goes, and they're both just talking to each other. And he said that he couldn't even
stay in the room?
Yeah. He was like, it was like I was a tough crowd, he says to me.
A lot of young comics, right?
Yeah.
He grew up on it. So to everyone, you know, you guys, you're just like, oh, those fucking guys. But if you grew up watching that on TV, forget about it.
I forget that got ended in 2004. We're 12 years removed. And I really do forget how many comedians watch that coming up. Like, you know, if you're 30 now, you were fucking 18 or 17 when that was on. To me, it's just a thing that we did.
Because that's what, it was a big deal. Like, I listened to Opie and Anthony in high school. And when you guys got taken off the air, Tough Crowd was like the next thing.
Dude, I segued right into it. I fucking lily pad jumped from one coattail to another. You've never seen more dexterity on a moderately talented man.